Local programming on KRWG Public Media made possible in part by viewers like you. Thank you.
This is KRWG Public Media, TV, radio, online, news that matters. Now, across the Mesilla Valley and the borderland, the stories that shape our community. From the KRWG Broadcast Center at New Mexico State University, this is Newsmakers.
Thanks for joining us on this special edition of Newsmakers. I'm Fred Martino. In honor of Veterans Day week, we are presenting the new documentary, A Rendezvous with Destiny. This film focuses on three of the last remaining 101st D-Day paratroopers. One, Dan McBride, is a hometown hero to Silver City. Stay tuned after the documentary when I'll speak with the film's director, Tracie Hunter.
Today, a milestone in the modernization of the United States Army is the new 101st Airborne Division.
All-purpose units which can fly at a moment's notice to trouble spots anywhere in the world.
I've told my kids most of the stories. I think that everybody should get an idea what the hell a war is all about so they avoid it. I hope the hell nobody ever has to go through that again, but the way things are going, you don't know. I got a very good memory. I can remember a lot of things that I'm really happy to remember, and I got a lot of things I wish I could forget, but I can't. You gotta put it behind you and just live your life. We knew a war was coming. And my dad had always talked up the Army. He was a corporal in the 37th Division, 145th Infantry in World War I. So I wanted to be part of it.
You know, that age, 17, 18, 19, sort of looking forward, maybe we're going to get in the war. You want something to happen.
We would listen on the radio to Hitler rambling along. It got to the point that I understood that if France and Britain didn't have some help, they were going down the tube. And people said, no, we're not going to go over and help them. That's welfare. And I said, no, it isn't welfare. We're not going over to bail them out. We're going over to join with them, get rid of this guy.
We went to a show, and they had a newsreel showing experimenting with parachute troops. Showed the French doing it and the Russians doing it, and then they showed the Americans. And my girl said, man, they must be so brave. And I said, yeah, they gotta be so stupid, because I was afraid of heights. But the idea stuck with me, and I got to thinking, if they can do it, there ain't no reason I can't do it. I was up on the roof of our house in a snowstorm, putting woods, you know, across the rafters. My mother was living in the house, you know, so she opened the window and turned the radio on. That's when Roosevelt was saying where the Japs had bombed Pearl Harbor and the state of war existed. My dad says, them sons of bitches. So I waited to my 18th birthday and I signed up.
Yeah, you see guys that are just a little bit older than you being drafted. So you knew it was coming, but I also knew I'd never be drafted. I knew I was going to enlist. It's sort of funny, I went down, enlisted, and left that same day.
The 101st Airborne was formed on the 16th of August, 1942. They took the 82nd Infantry Division and split it in two, made two airborne divisions.
You wanted to do something different, and the paratroopers were different. It was a new branch of service. And so when you went through the processing, they asked you, preference of branch? Yeah, I want to be a paratrooper. You had to volunteer. They didn't draft you and say you're in the paratroopers. $50 extra a month didn't affect me at all. I didn't even think about that.
When I went through jump school, you had a choice. You could go to the 101st or the 82nd. And I liked the looks of the Eagle better than I did the double A, so I went to the 101st. And an Eagle always screams as it attacks. We were the screaming Eagles.
And Colonel Sink was a graduate of West Point, put him in charge. And he came up with what he said was the parachute basic. So from the middle of July until 1st of December, we went through this parachute basic. And we went from 6,500 people to 1,650 people.
So that made us awful cocky, you know. We figured, right, we can do it, you can't, see?
We had hard training. 5 miles, 6 miles, 10 miles. The 506 was the first one to do it. They had to march 50 miles. So the 501, we had to do the same thing.
All our training was for one thing, and that was to lead the invasion. We didn't know where or when, but for 2 years, that's what we trained for.
I'd never been in an airplane before. And so the first airplane I got in, I had to jump out of it.
Colonel Sink had us out on a hillside and he said, you guys are unhappy. And he said, yeah, you don't like the food, no. And you think I'm too hard on you, yeah. And he said, well, I'll tell you what, it's gonna get a hell of a lot worse before it gets any better. And he just turned and walked away, and that was the end of it.
One day in England, we made a bad jump. Instead of landing out in a big field, we went and blew us into this little town. One guy went through the window of a house. I hit a barbed wire fence, busted off two posts, and got all scratched up. And somebody says, you know, we're going to pay for this when we get older. And the sergeant says, what makes you think you're going to get older? You know, and that kind of put a damper on things for a few minutes, but everybody figured, well, you guys might die, but not me.
Soldiers, sailors, and airmen of the Allied Expeditionary Force, you are about to embark upon the great crusade toward which we have striven these many months. The eyes of the world are upon you.
It was still daylight on the night of June 5th when we took off. Then we're flying out, we're right over the invasion fleet. It looked like the whole channel was moving. I didn't think there was that many ships in the world. And I was standing in the door 600 feet above them, and the moonlight shining on the waters, and that was the most magnificent sight I think I've ever seen.
We didn't go in over the beaches. We went around and came in parallel to the beaches.
When we crossed the coast, we run into a fog bank, and all the pilots panicked. They separated, didn't want to run into each other.
These pilots were fresh pilots. They'd never been in a combat before. And they're about the same age as many of us.
There's streams of tracer bullets coming up, and anti-aircraft fire busting all around. You could hear it hitting the plane.
So they became like fighter pilots. They hit the deck. I mean, they went down and they began to maneuver and swoosh back and forth. You had to hang on the anchor line to keep your balance.
Yeah, that process, when a red light comes on, you get up and there's a cable runs above your head and you got a static line 20 foot long and you got a snap fastener and you snap that on. The first guy, the guy behind him, checks his equipment and then said, okay. And then he turns around, that guy checks him, and then it goes down the line, then the last guy does it, and then he turns around, they do it to him. So you all are checked.
My platoon leader, I still remember, he said, Klein, I want you to jump last and make sure everybody gets out. And I vowed after the whole thing was over, never again will I jump last. Too many times their plane got hit. But if you were near the door, you got out. But if you were back a ways, you went down with the plane.
Had an engine on fire and we went out through fire. And the co-pilot came back and said, you want to jump now? And we said, how long is it going to be before we get to where we jump? And he said, well, maybe 10 or 15 minutes. And somebody said, you think you can hold it that long? And he said, we can as long as the wing stays on.
And so you're supposed to yell Billy Lee. Well, hell, nobody even thought about Billy Lee or Geronimo or anything else. No, the only thing I thought of, France, here I come.
I was jumping a third position, see? He was going too low and too fast. And he turned the green light on. Lieutenant went out and the sergeant went out, and I'm just reaching for a switch to turn the bundles loose under the plane loose. And just as I was reaching for it, he rolled the plane sideways. That threw me out the door head first. My shins hit the bottom of the door, and I somersaulted. And the first thing you do, you look up to check the chute. So I looked up, and there was a ground. And I looked down, and there was a chute. Now, I'd never been to France before, but it didn't look right to me. The second I saw what it was, I bent over. I was going to try and crawl up my leg. And just as I bent over, I slammed into the ground, and the lights went out. And I don't know if I lay there for 10 seconds or 10 minutes or an hour. I have no idea. But all of a sudden, I came aware of the fact that I'm laying in knee-deep wet grass, and everything hurt. Even my hair hurt. And I didn't know which way to go. See, I knew we weren't where we were supposed to be. And it's overcast, so I couldn't see the stars or, you know, judge your distance.
It was still pretty dark, and you couldn't really see very far. So we really didn't know where we were. And somebody called up a, a pole and read what it was. And once he did that, then we were oriented. We knew where we were. And then the guys started drifting off to where they're supposed to go.
When you land, you're supposed to go the way your plane came, which makes sense because the guys jumped ahead of you, but it doesn't always work that way.
Then I heard somebody walking through the grass fast. And in my imagination, I figured it was an 8-foot-tall German or a machine gun or something, see? And so I squatted down there trying to silhouette him against the sky. Well, I couldn't because there was a hedgerow behind him. It was too high. But I could see a movement, you know? And all of a sudden, he stopped. So I pulled out my clicker and I clicked it, and that German said, moo! The whole stampede of cows went off through there. You know, it sounded like 100 of them sound like, but I don't know how many were.
Here was a dirt road. It was a road I think the farmers probably used to get their fields with their carts. So I went, 15, 20, 25 minutes, I don't know how long, and I saw a silhouette, a helmet. And we had the password, Flash Thunder. So I said, Flash. And the only report I got was, it's me. It was a kid I knew, my platoon. So finally it began to get daylight. And I was pretty cautious about walking down the road in the daylight. So I made a decision, we'll get off the road and dig in and just wait.
It gets light about 4:30 that time of the year over there. I come to the end of a hedgerow. There's a branch hanging down in front. So instead of walking around it, I picked it up like this to walk under it. When I picked it up, there was a burst of machine gun fire. It went through that bush. And I dropped down on the ground. I thought it was one of our guys, you know, and I forget, dummy. I pulled out the clicker and I clicked it. That bought another burst. So I sneaked back along the hedge when I knew about where he was and got back there and took a grenade. I pulled the pin, let the handle fly off, and it goes 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, and I tossed it up over the hedgerow. And when it went off, I run up on top and emptied that carbine. But he was in bad shape, you know. He was dead. But his gun's laying there. And I picked it up, and I didn't know where the controls were, but I figured he'd been shooting it, so it must be ready. And I start moving off, and I caught a movement in the brush over there, and I pulled up and was going to shoot, and they said, I don't know, and I go click, click. And they go click, 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 click. Here's my buddy Grininger. And this is 4 hours since we jumped, and neither one of us had seen anybody since. You know, and we almost kissed each other, you know. And I was scared, there ain't no question about it. You know, anybody that says he wasn't, either he wasn't there or a damn liar, one of the two.
You're scared a lot all the time, but you can't let that fear rule you. You suppress that. It's there in the back of your mind. Even though we know what the casualties would be, each of us had a feeling we never expressed to anybody that we were going to be the exception, we weren't going to be killed.
As it lightened up, we'd move faster. We thought we was going quiet, but evidently we weren't, because somebody hollered out, "Flash." We said, "Thunder." He said, "Welcome." Went over, there was a lieutenant and two guys from the 82nd Airborne. And I said, "Lieutenant, where in the hell are we?" And he says, "Well," he says, "after looking at my maps and studying the country around here," he says, "I think, now I'm not sure, but I think we're someplace in Europe." There was a house on the other side of a hedge over there, and he says, "Go through that gate and see what's there." So I went through the gate, and I see somebody laying up on one arm, and he says, "Was ist los?" Well, I pulled around with a rifle, and he pulled up with his, and we both pulled the trigger. His went bang, mine went click. And I knew I was hit, but I didn't know where. You know, and the first thing I did, I dropped the rifle and grabbed the grenade. And I slammed it at him and I turned around to get away from the blast. You know, and I dropped down the gun and the thing went off. And I looked up and I'm looking right down the barrel of M1 rifle. The guy says, "Is that you, Mac?" I said, "Yeah." He says, "Are you hit?" I said, "Yeah." But the bullet went through my arm, cut a groove across here, and went out underneath. They gave me four prisoners and told me to walk them back to the beach and report to the medic. And I walked up to the surgeon, had a tent there with a red cross on it, on the beach. And I said, "I'm supposed to report to you." He says, "You've been wounded?" I said, "Yeah, but it's just a little." He said, "Get on the boat." I said, "Yeah, but it's just a little." He said, "Get on the damn boat." Well, you don't argue with a colonel, so I got on the damn boat. About that time, they brought my lieutenant in. He's laying on his belly in a stretcher. I can see his pants are all bloody, you know. I said, "Where are you hit, Lieutenant?" He said, "You know damn well where I'm hit. A bullet went right through both cheeks of his ass, you know." And we call him the only man in Europe with five ass.
Our main objective then was to capture Carentan, because it was a fairly decent sized city. But we then formed a line with the 82nd Airborne to keep the Germans from getting to the beaches. They always say there's never an atheist in a foxhole. I believe that. And I was in a little orchard, and for some reason the Germans laid a fire on that orchard. There was already a slit trench in there, so I got jumped in the slit trench. And that was when I gained religion. I prayed my heart out, "Help me."
We were in this defilade where the cattle went through, banks on each side, and German artillery and American artillery both were shooting at us, and the place was littered with bodies. Oh, hell, it was awful. And we were sitting there up against the bank, and a mortar shell came down and went into one of the guys and cut the bottom part of his heart off, and he just turned white. I remember looking at that and thinking about it, you know, that could have been me too.
Preparations in England for the airborne operations of 17th September. The 1st Allied Airborne Army is ready to take off from scores of fields to invade the Rhine Delta of the Netherlands. The forces participating in the largest assault of its kind are the U.S. 82nd and 101st Airborne Divisions, veterans of the D-Day landings in Normandy. The paratroopers are loaded into hundreds of C-47 transports.
It was a daylight jump. The planes flew in perfect formation. They didn't split up like they did in Normandy. I jumped number one, by the way, because finally, we're issued big radios. You just dropped them on your back. So if you jumped the radio, they had to put you first because you had this big radio attached to your leg. So we got into a little town, and it had a church, and it had a windmill, one of the few windmills that I saw in Holland. and my lieutenant said that we'll make that our OP.
It wasn't like normally. We weren't bragging about what we're going to do going in either, because we'd already been there and we knew what was going on now. And it's a little different when you've been there.
We were on an outpost up in there, and this slimy colonel comes up and says, "I say, I want you chaps to take a patrol and find out what Jerry's doing up in here." And we said, "Yeah, we can do that tonight." He said, "Oh, I want a daylight patrol." So I was carrying a 42-pound machine gun, a box of ammunition, and the seven of us. We had a medic with us, and we snuck around. We got 3 miles behind the German lines. We were going along a dike, because it's all swamp down below, you know. And the Germans evidently spotted us, because I heard the shell coming, and I knew it was going to be close. So I ducked down like this, and I started running, see? And I did. The shell hit behind me and vaporized the guy behind me. And between my running and the boost I got from that blast, it blew me off this dike and went down into the swamp, and this 42-pound machine gun comes spinning down, landed barrel first right on this ankle. Right there. It crushed all the bones in that ankle. The medic we had with us took a tube of Novocaine and shot it right through the boot in there. And I had to walk about 6 miles to get out of there. And every step I could feel the bones grating back and forth, you know. Anyway, I've had pain in that constantly, day and night, for 75 years. And it's just as much now as it has been the rest of the time.
My best friend, Jake Wingard, he married just before we went overseas. What a honeymoon, about a week. He was the sergeant in charge of two mortars, and I was his radio man. So we went into the windmill, and our infantry guys from G Company, H Company, I Company came up, and they formed a line opposing the German line. So he gave a fire order to me, and I called back to the mortars. Well, he had to stand in that window to see. And I knew he must have known that they could see him, because he was like a sore thumb sticking out and standing in this window. And so he gave a fire order. And now you fire, and you can hear the mortars go off, so you can wait a few seconds. Then you have to look and see where they're hitting. And he had to step on that window again to see where the mortars landed and then make an adjustment. And the next thing I knew, he turned to me, he says, "I'm dead, I'm dead." And I caught him and I laid him down. I'm yelling, "Medic, medic," and no medic around. So I went back and the lieutenant said, "He's gone."
Well, something hit me, and I don't know what it was. Every shell that hits the ground explodes in pieces, and they fly around there hot. So when it hits you, it's not just an injury, it's the heat.
Whenever there's fighting going on, somebody's going to get it. You anticipate this. It's going to happen, and you're going to have to go on.
Here's a road 60 miles long. The whole 60 miles going through enemy territory, and we're going in with not enough people, really. And those people across the river, 10,000 British people and Polish people, were supposed to get relieved within 2 or 3 days, and that didn't happen. And of course, we heard that it was a failure. Tell that to a third of the people of Holland, who were liberated a year before the rest of Holland was. Tell them it was a failure and see what they tell you.
This was the Battle of the Bulge. The entire world awaited the fateful outcome as the armies of Nazi Germany lashed out in the counteroffensive in the Ardennes, on which Germany gambled everything.
We were pulled out of Holland, I say, around Thanksgiving.
They'd have us all lined up for a mission, like we were supposed to land at Rambouillet, France, and take the airport. Well, by the time we got down the planes ready to go, they canceled it because Patton had just went through there, you know. And they had 3 or 4 different things like that.
We went to Reims, France, took us by truck down there. And we were put in a camp at Napoleon, one of his camps. The barracks were quite nice.
We turned in all of our machine guns and mortars and things like that. Most of our rifles were turned in to be redone. We turned in all of our extra clothing. We were going to go to the States and have a furlough and then go to Guam to get ready to go to Japan.
And they handed out passes to Paris. And I thought, no rush, I'll wait to go to Paris. Besides, it's December, it's cold. The armies don't fight during bad weather, you know, they like good roads and so on. Well, Hitler hoodwinked the Allies on that one.
See, they took the cast off my leg the 10th of December. The 16th of December, the Germans broke through. The 18th, they woke us up at 2 o'clock in the morning, flipped the lights on, and everybody fall out.
Sergeant came in. I asked, what the hell's going on? He said, there's been a breakthrough and you guys are going. I said, oh, hell, we're not going any place. Hell, we don't have any weapons. We don't have any ammunition, no K rations. He said, you're going.
So they put us on cattle trucks and they take off going.
No airplanes, went by truck because they had to get us up there in a hurry.
And they loaded us in them standing up. They could hardly move. We started out with lights on. And then I knew this was for real.
And everybody else is coming this way, and we're going that way. And rumor started, these guys are coming up their front, and we're going back. They're going back to the States to sell war bonds. See? We didn't know it, but these guys are all retreating, and we're going up.
So we got up there on the 19th. Drove all night with the lights on the trucks because they didn't worry about the German Air Force.
We stopped and everybody get out and they're throwing snowballs at each other and everything else, you know. And the officers had to go to the head of the column. And they come back and they says, well, they got the dope. The Germans broke through and we got a hole in this place. And he says, what is this place? And he said, I don't know, someplace in Belgium, you know. So it was in Bastogne.
There's seven roads and three railroads in that town. And this area is swampy and hilly, and they have to have roads before they can do it. If you hold that town, we can stop them. And that's why that was so damned important.
And we held it all right.
We stopped on the outskirts of Bastogne. It was the first time we'd ever seen American troops. They were retreating.
And some of them were just out of their mind. And it's all these guys coming back toward us, and where in the hell did you guys come from? Oh, they're killing everybody up there. So what are you going to do? He said, we're going up to fight. He said, they'll kill you. They're killing everybody.
So we went right through Bastogne, out this little called Mont, and put our battalion, our regiment, formed a line there.
If they couldn't get Bastogne, they couldn't win this war. Didn't matter what it was or how many people were involved, we were told, you're going in and you're never going to fail.
And the Germans then made their attack. So during that attack, I got hit pretty good. There was an explosion, and to this day, I don't know what it was. My first thought was, I hope it's bad enough to get me home. My buddy from Columbus, Herb Oakley, he came over and he looked at the wound. He said, I hate to tell you this, Dick, but it's not good enough to get you home. And I felt like punching him. But when they got me to the hospital, the nerves have been cut. That's why I wore this brace. I've never been able to move my toes since then.
And of course, we weren't fighting in a city, we were fighting outside. But our headquarters and our facilities and our medics and everything were in the that area.
The Germans had us surrounded there, and they sent a surrender message in. Surrender or we're going to annihilate the town and the civilians in it, and plus your troops. And our General McAuliffe sent a one word back, nuts. And the German envoy said, well, what's nuts mean? He says, it means go to hell.
You know, there's no heroes. I don't give a damn what you say. There's no heroes. When we got out of Bastogne, nobody had had their clothes off in a month. You could smell us 2 blocks away, and crummy looking, the helmets were all black from trying to cook in them, and all the paint burned off them, you know. And there's nothing glamorous about it whatsoever. And you're scared all the time and hungry. Can't tell what it's like to go for 4 or 5 days without any sleep at all and laying in mud, you know, and somebody trying to kill you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, you know. You could die at any time. It feels like a little bit of you goes every time one of these guys goes. You know, you funny thing, you get back and you look at the empty bunk, you know, when you go back to England. Yeah, kind of gets to you. When Gunninger died, that got to me more than anything else in the whole war. In my mind, I figured that if anybody deserved to live, it was Gunninger. Because he had a wife and a little baby he'd never seen. He'd get a letter and a picture every time we had mail. And he always was volunteering to go on patrol because he could speak German like a native. You see, he had a premonition. We were attacking this little town. We'd bedded down for the night. And the temperature was way down below zero, you know. I was kind of heat up a K-ration to eat, you know. And looked over at him, and he's tearing up his sleeping bag. And during the night, his feet had swelled up so much he couldn't get his boots back on. So he was tearing up his sleeping bag and wrapping around his feet. I said, Christ, Johnny, you're going to need that tonight. He said, no, I won't. I said, well, I will still be up here. He said, yeah, but I won't need it. I won't need anything. I'm going to die today. I said, oh, yeah, you never talked like this before. He said, no, Mac, I'm not fooling you. I'm going to die today. And to come, like he said, I'm going to have a cup of coffee, you know. So he took 3 men, and I had 3. And we was moving up, and we had a deal between us. I'd move for 20 minutes, then he'd pass me in 20 minutes, then I'd pass him. That even the chances up with somebody running in trouble. Okay? Well, about the third trade, I had pulled mine over. He went past, you know, and he walked over the hill. And I was following him, and I heard a machine gun open up from far off. It didn't even associate it with us. And I got over the hill, and I looked, and there was somebody laying in the snow, all backwards, like this. Went down there, it was Gunninger, deader than hell. And when that happened, I flipped. I went completely bonkers. I threw the damn gun down, and I started running at that machine gun. And one of these rookies tackled me and sit on me, you know. And from that time on, I didn't have any fear at all. I just figured, I'm going to die in this damn war. Let it happen right now and get it over with, you know, just to get me out of this misery.
Every time you go in combat, you lose a few of the old people. The first time you come in, you lose a lot of them. Then you smarten up a little bit. We didn't lose our nerve. We just didn't want to be the last people killed. Just somebody came out in the street and said, it's all over. And that's how we knew it. There was no official proclamation or anything.
Well, we went overseas. We left New York Harbor September 4th, 1943. There was 119 men in the company. Out of that 119, when the war ended, there were 9.
You can't understand how it is to put down all that uncertainty, just great relief.
4 of us decided to go home because we had enough points to do it. And the other 5 wanted to stay and tour Europe and see what it looked like with nobody shooting at them.
The first time I could say, I made it. No worry about submarines or anything else. We're now in the harbor. And in New York. Beautiful thing. That's one of the impressions I had. First time I'd ever seen Statue of Liberty.
When I first come home, you know, everybody during the war thought all American soldiers had a halo over their head, and all the Germans had horns, and the Japs had pointed tails, you know, and our purpose was to liberate Europe. We had no animosity toward anybody. Wasn't mad at nobody. We was just doing our job. They're doing theirs.
A German parachute officer got shot through the head, and I took his camera, and I got back to England, and I had that film developed. It shows three little boys sitting on a log, and an older man looked like could have been the grandfather. So you see there's tragedy on both sides.
To hate a person, to hate a nation, I just can't cope with it.
Wars end. You're going to have to live in this world with people. It's not going to be a country isolated anymore. We're going to have to deal in a world where everybody was with everybody.
You're hired to do a job. You do your job, you get paid for it, that's it. The way we looked at it, our country's calling, you answer it. You know, you're doing this for your country.
We volunteered for it, we got trained for it, we got paid for it.
I did my duty. I never considered myself a hero. The ones that get killed are the heroes. But there's a lot of guys that did things like never got a medal. They did it, no one even was aware of it.
The idea of somebody saying, they gave their life. Nobody gives their life. You know, I've seen a lot of men die, but I never saw anybody give their life. You gave your service to your country. You didn't give your life, somebody takes it.
Why we work. We're not looking for glory. We're looking for results.
For about the first week after I was home, I couldn't go to sleep unless I had my .45 in my hand, because I'd been used to sleeping that way. You know, I didn't want to talk about it too much, except to my family, you know, my dad, and, you know.
All I wanted to do was get married, find a piece of land, and build a house.
It never bothered me to talk about it. I know a lot of people that they say, oh, my dad wouldn't talk about the war.
You don't lose your humanity. All you do is put it on hold for a while. You go to war because it's necessary. I am extremely proud to have served in the 101st because we were, as they call it, the trip of the spear and all of that, because of what we did and the way we did it. And that's not bragging at all, it's just what happened.
I think it's the best division in the whole armed forces. Every mission they ever had, they made a success out of it. D-Day, Operation Market Garden, and the Bulge, they were all successes as far as I'm concerned.
We were the first division in the history of the United States Army to get the presidential citation as a whole division for Bastogne.
Sure it was worth it, damn right it was worth it. And I'd do it under the same conditions again.
I think Jake would think it was worth it if he could see what the appreciation that the Dutch have, if he could see how they take care of that graveyard.
When I see these people healthy, happy, and everything, it makes me feel good to think that I might have had a small part in helping them be like that. Because you could tell the difference the way the people looked when we jumped in there. They looked all downtrodden, you know, and afraid to look you in the eye and everything. Now you go over there and they're, hey, how you doing, buddy, you doing?
As long as you're physically fit and mentally fit, do what you can do.
Take advantage of good health, and do what you can to make it better.
I'm in my 100th year, and I may or may not jump again. I have told people I'm not going to, but there are a lot of optimists. They've got a jump set up for me when I'm 101, another 105, and we'll see what happens if I'm still here.
We were required to sing this song when you're going through jump school because they're trying to make us quit. And to sing this song, it's something that could possibly happen. See? Is everybody happy? Cried the sergeant, looking up. Our hero feebly answered yes, and then they stood him up. He jumped right out into the blasters, said he climbed on the hook, and he ain't gonna jump no more. Glory, glory, what a hell of a way to die. Glory, glory, what a hell of a way to die. Glory, glory, what a hell of a way to die, and he ain't gonna jump no more.
Glory, glory, what a hell of a way to die. Glory, glory, what a hell of a way to die. Glory, glory, what a hell of a way to die. He ain't gonna jump no more.
He counted long, he counted loud, he waited for the shock. He felt the wind, he felt the clouds, he felt the awful drop. He jerked his cord, the silk spilled out and wrapped around his legs. He ain't gonna jump no more. Glory, glory, what a hell of a way to die. Glory, glory, what a hell of a way to die. Glory, glory, what a hell of a way to die.
A wonderful documentary, A Rendezvous with Destiny, and I'm pleased to have with us the film director, Tracie Hunter. Tracie, I know you have told other stories of our veterans' service. Tell me how you came upon this story and decided it was right for a documentary film.
Absolutely. So we had been working with World War II veterans for years, and this story came to us from a gentleman in the Netherlands, Mr. Joost Groen, and he actually wrote a book about these three men. So it was really interesting that somebody from another country had so much interest in our veterans. And he presented this book and told me about the three men, Mr. Dan McBride, Mr. Jim Pee-wee Martin, and Mr. Dick Klein. And after reading the book and talking to the veterans, I just knew this was such a special story that we, as our organization, Beyond the Call, really wanted to tell and highlight three of the last World War II Screaming Eagles, which was the Airborne Division. And all three of these men were in Normandy and Market Garden and the Battle of the Bulge. So it was just, their stories are amazing, you know, from start to finish, and this new experimental division in the military. And they all each had such different experiences, even though they went through the same battles. And so it really was a story that touched our hearts, and the men, we fell in love with them so quick. So
I bet you did. And of course, among those three veterans, you mentioned Dan McBride, who is from Silver City. Tell me about the process of finding the veterans and convincing them to participate. We know that they were in this book, but of course, it's one thing to talk to an author and very much another to be talking to a documentary filmmaker with a camera there, a little different process.
Yeah, so Dan was actually my first veteran that we interviewed for this project. And I remember the first phone call with him. I was nervous. I had never talked to him before. Obviously, so much respect for what he had done. And we talked for about an hour. And at the end of the call, I said, well, can we come out and film you? He said, yeah, you seem like a nice lady, so yeah, I'll let you come. So we came out there and spent a weekend with him. And we really tried to make sure that we're not just focused on filming, that we're focused on forming relationships as well with our veterans. So Dan spent the whole weekend with us. He took us out to his friend's ranch. And, you know, we were able to meet the friends at his American Legion and just really get to be a part of his life. And since then, we've become such great friends. So It was just so exciting to meet this man who had just, he's 97 now and has spent so much of his life dedicated to our country and also to the stories of the men who didn't come back. He's really the voice for the ones who were left behind and lost. So it was just absolutely a huge honor to get to spend time with him and become such good friends since.
Well, Tracie, as you know, we are losing so many of our World War II veterans, so time is of the essence to preserve these stories. Tell me about that as a driver for you.
That is a huge drive for us, and it's one that is just a daily heartbreak because the reality is we cannot get to every single veteran before this generation is gone, but we can do our best, and it takes a global effort. There's so many great veteran organizations that are doing similar work. We're making sure these guys and gals are remembered and honored. And so for us, you know, we know when we make that phone call and say, can we come interview you? Sometimes 2 weeks after the interview, we've lost these veterans. And so we know the value of these stories. And once they're gone, the stories are gone, the history is gone with them. And so it is so crucial to make sure that we're preserving these stories as much as possible while we still have the generation left.
I know your work is part of a nonprofit, Beyond the Call. Tell me about that and how it came to be.
Yes, so Beyond the Call is our nonprofit, and it's run by three amazing women who all have military backgrounds. And we travel around and interview World War II veterans and document their stories. And the way it came about, my grandfather was in World War II and was a POW. And then I also grew up an Army brat. My dad served for 22 plus years in the Army. And so the military was just something that was really important to me and making sure the stories were told. And my grandfather had a really hard time coming home from the war. You know, I don't think he had a lot of places to talk about it, or he just kind of got back to work, got a family, and did his job. He stayed in the military. But it was something that I said, you know, I would love for a place for these people to have a safe place to share these stories and to know that what they did mattered. It matters to our generation. It will matter to generations to come because we're still enjoying the liberties and freedoms that that generation gave us to this day. And so it was something that myself and the other two women, Elizabeth Suter and Ashley Andrews, felt was so important to make sure that their stories were documented. So we started Beyond the Call back in 2019.
I want to follow up on what you said there, a safe place to tell the stories. I wanted to ask you about your process in working with veterans on their stories. Sometimes, as you know, vets talk to very few people, if any, about parts of their service. Tell me how you help them to open up so that this history is preserved.
I think I would say, as a filmmaker, one of the most important things before you ever pick up the camera is to build a relationship and to let your subject know that they can trust you with their story. We're not coming in just to get the gory war stories or anything. We're coming in because what they did mattered. They're the voices of the people that didn't come home, and their stories and what they did are still relevant to today. So I would say relationships are the number one thing for us. And once the cameras are put down, we stop talking about the war. We take them to lunch. We celebrate their birthdays. You know, we have fun with them and ask about the other 70 plus years of their life, get to know their wives, their kids, grandkids, and just try to make sure that we're not re-traumatizing anyone, because this is really heavy content that these people are remembering back to.
Yeah. I know Dan McBride of Silver City talks about this in the film. He wanted to share his story to help encourage all of us to avoid war at all costs.
Yes. Dan went through some of the toughest battles. He's a Purple Heart recipient. He lost many friends right beside him. And I think his hope is that they did that so we don't have to anymore, and that we can, you know, find ways to maybe at least tolerate one another's differences to avoid war. But I think after seeing so much loss, you know, Dan is one of those that just celebrates life so much and lives to the fullest. And I think he wants that for everyone, and hopes that what they did back then can be preserved and continued today.
Is this something you hear from other veterans, that part of their decision to talk about their service is connected to encouraging us to avoid war when we can?
I think it's a combination. I think obviously many of my veterans have expressed that, one of them, I'll quote him, "War is the ultimate failure of mankind." And though they feel at times it was necessary, you know, nobody wants to go to war. Nobody wants to have to fight and to lose people they loved. But I think one of the biggest drives for our veterans is in talking, especially ones that haven't talked, is they know that they're, when they go, the stories of the men and women who were killed in action or didn't come home go with them. And so they feel this duty and honor to remember the lives lost and their comrades back in battle.
Former NBC anchor Tom Brokaw famously wrote about this generation of Americans in his book, The Greatest Generation. What are your thoughts on its influence in helping raise awareness of the sacrifices and the contributions made by this great generation of people?
That's a big question to answer. There's so many thoughts and feelings when I think about this generation. Like I said, still today, the fact that I can sit here and talk with you freely, that can be traced back to the heroism and bravery of our greatest generation and what they did, you know, 75 plus years ago now. And just feeling grateful for that every day and waking up and knowing that each day is a gift and that the greatest generation truly, you know, they're named the greatest generation for a reason. They are just incredible. And I think that we can't go a day without recognizing that we have a lot of freedoms that were given to us because of these men and women who are still with us today, even though they may be aging and older, you know, they're still with us. And so there's still some time left to thank them.
They saved the world.
They did.
That's the bottom
line. They absolutely did.
They saved the world. You know, I have a hard time getting my head around how some of this generation, people who sacrificed so much to literally save the world, how some of them must feel seeing the time that we're living in right now with the January 6th insurrection at the Capitol, seeing their fellow citizens try to stop a peaceful transfer of power. I know that it's different for each individual, but I can't imagine, this must be extremely difficult for some of them.
I would say that if we look back at history and remember it, you see that goodness prevails, you know, through so many different times in our history. Goodness always prevails, and there will always be men and women that will stand up and will do the right thing. And we have evidence of that from the greatest generation.
Yeah, it really is important to remember that. And World War II, it's important, I think, to talk about it because of the historical context that we've already discussed, but also important in another way that I'm sure many of the people watching this right now are feeling. I know I am feeling this, that even though in my family I don't have any relatives who are alive right now who are in the military or who are veterans, I lost one of my grandfathers in World War II and had other relatives who served in World War II. I'm sure you hear that from a lot of people, that this is extremely personal in addition to the historical context.
Absolutely. I think that whether your relative was either serving abroad or at home during World War II, everybody really was helping the war effort, whether it was at home in a factory or in the service. And so it's something that I feel like I haven't met anybody that doesn't have a connection to it in some way, shape, or form. And so it is really moving. You know, we'll be out with our veterans and we'll have families come up and just say, can my kid meet them? You know, they just recognize that they did, they saved the world, and that they, you know, want to recognize that for generations to come.
This is always a difficult question, but when you produce a film like this, what do you most want people to take away from it?
You know, I think that if you watch these films and you may not remember the names of the battles or the dates or the names of the soldiers, I want people to remember how it made them feel when they see these men and women who at the time were kids step up and do something that was so honorable and noble and helped save the world. And so I want people to go home with how they felt and take that in their daily lives. You know, how can I make a difference in my day, even if it's, you know, big or small ways, you know, just those conscious decisions of continuing that mentality and character from the greatest generation.
That certainly was part of how I felt. I stopped after watching this and thought about their service of others during World War II. Just got about a minute left. Final thoughts from you and what you have planned next.
We have one more coming out this year called The Monument of Tolerance, and it follows a paratrooper, a German veteran, and Holocaust survivors that have come together each year to talk about reconciliation. So that's coming out later this year that we're excited about. But I think final thoughts, I would just say, when you see veterans, just say thank you for your courage and just recognize them, because you just don't know what people have gone through. You know, they're so humble, they don't talk about themselves so often. And so just take a little bit extra time to make sure that they're remembered.
Very important message. Tracie Hunter. Tracie, thank you so much for sharing this, and thank you for your work. We really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having us and for honoring Dan and all the other men and women from World War II.
Thanks. Well, that is our time for now. Join us this week on KRWG Radio every weekday. It's Morning Edition 5 to 9, Fresh Air at 11, followed by Here and Now, noon to 2, and All Things Considered 4 to 7. KRWG News is always online at krwg.org, and we'd love to hear from you. Email us with your story ideas and video submissions. The address is feedback@nmsu.edu. Thank you to all of our veterans and for all of us at KRWG News. I'm Fred Martino. Have a good week. We'll see you next time on Newsmakers.